constantly. Happy New Year, everybody. It is Thursday, January 4th at 9 o'clock. And just as I had said last week, I really wanted to start doing this weekly conversation. Okay. So, here we are. Happy New Year. I hope everyone is where they want to be. If you're in the Northeast, I hope you're nice and warm because it's brick outside. We had a snowstorm. Tor, did you guys get snow in Philadelphia? I think you guys got hit last week also. I'm not sure, but it's miserable. I haven't been outside all day and I'm not going out. So I'm here with you. I'm very nervous. Why should I be? But that's okay. I feel like if I feel jittery, then I'm doing the right thing. So we always know that, yeah, you got some snow. We always know that, you know, nerves are an indication that we're going in the right direction. So this week I was having that conversation with my girlfriend, but I'll get into that. I want to let you know where I am in my home. I'm in my bedroom. I'm trying to figure out, like, what's the best place for me to feel comfortable and speak from my spirit and from my heart. And it's my lair, I must say. I don't know if you can hear the music in the background, but I got the music going. I got some incense burning, some black coconut and Obama incense. Oh yes, he even has incense. So just getting comfy. I have my salt lamp pumping right here. I would show it to you guys. Maybe I'll hold on. It's not even that warm.
Just turned it on.
This is a Himalayan salt lamp. No, my vagina is not glowing, although but it's a really healing lamp for your energy and your aura, and I'm so happy to have her. I just bought it for myself in the holidays, and so that's on. So it's pure vibes. Just came out the shower, so I'm feeling very nice and grounded. You have one of those, yes. Hi, cousin. Yeah, Tor, I like it. Let me know how you feel about it. I think it's pretty dope. Hey, cuz, is that hand is your color. No shade. All right, so here we are, 2018. We're starting off. I'm looking to do this on Thursday evenings. I was aiming for 8 o'clock, but here we are at 9. I guess this is the time that God wants me to speak. And, yeah, that's what it's going to be. All right, so I'm going to do the best I can to stay involved in the message that I'm bringing you and not respond to the comments as much as I can. Not because I don't want to, but I don't want to lose my train of thought, and I don't want to distract you all either. So hello to everybody who's here, and I hope you stay. And yeah, so going back to what I just mentioned about me having a conversation with my girlfriend the other day, and I was talking to her. What was I saying? Okay, left me, it'll come back. But I do know the topic that I wanted to start talking about tonight is relationships and marriage. No, I'm not married, but I can still talk about it. So my intention here is to do this every Thursday and have a conversation about a wide variety of things. So relationships, marriage, situationships, sex, sexuality, genitalia, politics here and there, more historical references than current day. I think we get pounded enough. People's relationship to their spirituality and to who they pray to, who else. So many different things, so many different topics. But I want to start off today with marriage. And I got this really big message last week. I was talking to my best friend, and we were just talking about, I was talking to her about a situation that I've been involved in for quite some time. And just like, it just dropped down into me like, automatically, that a heavy message, that one of the biggest reasons I was invested. Anyone who knows me has known, you know, that I've always wanted to get married and have a family, and that's always just been something that's so important to me. And, you know, and then I have married friends and they're like, ah, you know, take your time, enjoy being single and this and that, and da da da. But what I wasn't really conveying was like this want was really so rooted in me, as if I knew about it from another time maybe, or that there was something connecting me to this desire that was bigger than myself. And in having this conversation with my best friend, I realized that, you know, I was really invested in trying to repair something inside myself that's already happened, right? So when I was a kid, my parents broke up when I was like 5 or 6 years old. And I think from that time, from 5 years old, I decided I'm going to get married and have a family. I'm happily 36 right now. That is 31 years ago. It's a long time to have a desire or make a commitment about something. But that's what I did. And I held on to this desire so strongly and for so long, you know. And it was gnawing at me, and it was nice that I cried about it, and it was like all that I could talk about and all that I could think about. And, you know, every time I would come across somebody I know who's married, I'm like, tell me your story. And, you know, and just watching rom-coms. And I do, I know, I understand that socially that gets put on women, you know. But it was just deeper than that. It was deeper than that for me. And so anyway, I'm having this conversation with my bestie last week, and I said, oh shit, I'm really putting all my coins into the fact that this impending marriage to this possible person is going to somehow change the fact that my parents broke up. It's going to somehow change the fact that I had to shuffle between two homes. It's going to somehow change the fact that I felt broken apart. It's going to somehow change the fact that I thought that I wasn't worthy of love. I thought that they broke up and it was my fault. I mean, all the chaos that happens with kids that come from some type of brokenness, and that could be no parents at all to one parent to being in a devised situation like divorce or separation. There's so many feelings that stay with you as a result of that. And, you know, it just dawned on me last week, like, that happened and it's over, and you getting married is not going to fix that. It's not going to change that. It's not going to repair it. And so I just felt really impacted by that, because I know for sure that I am not the only person at all who has had this thought process. And maybe some of us can't find the words for it, you know. But there's a lot of things, I think, that we do with this driving force because we think that we need to do it, or we think that we want it, or we think we need to have it, or whatever the case may be. And sometimes, oftentimes, it's really not even about that thing. It's really just about trying to repair what you felt like wasn't in your control to have or to keep. And, you know, and then it was just like, yo, this makes so much sense. Because I hear people say all the time, like, oh, marriage, you know, marriage isn't all it's cracked up to be. And you know, my opinion about marriage is this, is that it's not a forced place. You don't have to go there. This is the one thing, this is the one point that I just don't understand. Because a lot of people get married, you know, nobody made you do that. That was this decision that you made. So I always think it's interesting when people get real lit about marriage ain't shit. You get married, she changes. You get married, he changes. You get married, but nobody told you to go to that place. Especially, there's a lot of men. I mean, a lot of men in my life, you know, they get involved with women, and then, you know, they get involved with women. Situations happen, things occur. They marry the woman or they impregnate the woman, and then, you know, it's just an ever-ending spell of complaint. And it's like, but who sent you to go do that? No one sent you to do that. And furthermore, whether people agree with this or not, because it is what it is. And in these conversations that I have with you guys, it's really going to be about truth. And I'm just gonna tell the truth as I have been told it in my spirit. Marriage is an institution that is in God's house. If you don't want to live in God's house, get the hell out. don't go in there. You don't want to know what it means to really know who you are. You don't want to know what it means to confront who you are. You don't want to know what it means to have flaws. Be flawed. Check yourself. You don't want to know what it means to grow for yourself. But then you want to get married and do that nonsense with someone who else who doesn't also want to do that. Then what are you getting married for? No, it's not going to work. Of course you're going to have breakdowns and breakups and separations. It's not going to work. So, you know, that thought. Hi, Alexis. I'm glad you're here because I'm talking about what I talked to you about last week and having this revelation like, yo, you can't make a life commitment based on your past pain, your past wound. Our past wounds are ours to have, endure, experience, and heal from. And if we're making choices and commitments out of those wounds, then they're bound to have some type of repercussion. And I believe in prevention. I believe in thought process and taking a step back and taking a breath and not running into things, especially when it involves other people. So, you know, I feel like I should have had this conversation when this happened because I was just like so ignited by it and so much more that I wanted to say, but it'll come. And so the other part of my desire to be involved in a marriage has to do with being a nurturer and a mother and a partner. And, you know, I remember growing up and my grandmother, and Lisa, if you're still here, our grandmother, just being that rock for the family, you know. We all collectively as cousins had our own in our family. We come from a good-sized family, so we all had our own experiences with what was going on in our homes individually. And not that it was anything extremely negative, but it was things happening because that's life, you know. But my grandmother's house was always a place of really good food. The minute you walked in the door, really good food. You could smell it from the time you hit the door. Big open arms to hug you up and love you up. My grandfather was there yelling at the TV, yelling at the baseball game or whatever was on television. You can always guarantee they would be there and love you. And always a pot of rice and peas, always chamomile tea, always Excelsior Jamaican biscuits and ginger ale, always, thank you, always just always goodness. And it was just for the taking. And they never asked for anything in return. And I'm just so grateful to have experienced that. And as I close my eyes right now and I'm thinking about it, I can still see that house on 125th Street and Francis Lewis Boulevard in Queens. And with those brick steps and you walk up and you go inside and grandma was in the kitchen. And it just, you know, it was always home base for all of us, for her kids, for her grandkids. And I knew from a young age I wanted to be that woman also. You know, I wanted to be the woman who had a home that I could invite people in and say, come and eat. Are you hungry? Are you cold? You want to laugh? You want to relax? I want to create that space. And I actually really thank God for having that. You know, I'm so grateful because if I didn't have that peace, I wouldn't be trying to get married at all, truth be told. And I know it doesn't mean that you have to be married to do that. But for me, I'm looking forward to entering into that space in the Lord's house. I have no problem with that. It's just that place of honesty that I wanted to share with you all and maybe invite in the conversation of like, where are the places in your life where you feel like you've made lifelong decisions based off of your insecurities? You know, that could be anything. It could be jobs. It could be relationships. It could be, you know, hobbies and activities. It could be the people that you spend your time with, you know. I think it's important that we always kind of stay just at home with the fact that we want to be as rich as possible every day. That's how close to life I want to be. You know, I want to be here for all of this. And I don't want anything to interrupt that process, you know. And so if the sacrifice for that is actually getting down to the heart of what it is that drives me, then I want to get to that place. And I want to share it because I strongly feel this is not about me soapboxing or just wanting to talk because I talk a lot. It's really just, I know I'm not the only person. I can't be with these thoughts and these feelings. And so I just want to share that for people who have the same kind of feeling. So just to magnify on that a little bit more, I think I spoke to her like last Thursday or Friday. Me and her had this conversation. So, you know, it was like blowing my mind all week, and a new year came through. And, you know, like I said, I had somebody in my life that I had been with, and we were trying to work things out, and it goes back and forth. And, you know, there's all these instances in the situation, and we've had a lot of ups and downs. And, you know, but I can honestly say when I think about him, he's the only man I've dealt with that I feel I've grown so much in myself, my relationship with myself. And I don't even know how he did that. I don't know if that was an intention on his part. And I've heard him share that he's had the same or similar experience with my involvement in his life. But it's amazing to me that somebody can come into your life and impact you so strongly that it drives you to a higher place in who you are. And then that person may not even be your person. You know what I mean? Like, and, you know, that's something that I think we both came to realize. Like, okay, this may not be what this is for, but you helped me to expand my reach for where I want to go and who I want to be. So I just kept thinking about it all week. And to be really honest with you also, I spent much of the holiday season, you know, thinking, I was telling my best friend, I was like, you know what? Maybe he's getting me a ring. You know, maybe a ring is coming my way for Christmas. This is what's going on in my brain, you know, and you know, I'm concocting this grand situation and like, oh, wow, my family is like really calm because they know about some sensational thing that's getting ready to happen. This is the story that's going on in here. And, you know, Christmas came and Christmas went and no such thing occurred. And you know, it like ignited something in me like, well, what the hell is going on here? You know, but just getting down to the brass tacks of what I'm saying in sitting with myself and in being honest with myself, I realized I'm nowhere near ready for marriage. Not yet. And then I think marriage, like children, you never prepared, but I get that too. I think that's something sometimes that happens to you if it's the right thing, as opposed to you seeking it out. But yeah, I'm good. I'm not ready yet because what's involved in that is attached to where I'm growing to. And I haven't grown to that place yet. And I have a strong feeling that that person who will come into my life will assist me and grow into that space and me being open and available to him, lending me a hand to rise to that occasion. So, you know, the weekend went and Sundays I usually watch Joel Osteen in the morning and I turn on Joel Osteen and he's saying something in the message about, you know, being where you are and knowing that what's for you is for you. And, you know, it's just like, now it's compounding what I thought. And then same Sunday, I decided to go to church with my mom for New Year's. We went to Crystal Cultural Center in Brooklyn, Pastor Bernard. I hadn't been there in a while, but it was a really beautiful service, really positive. And he starts having this conversation with us about, in 2018, you want 2018 to be the year where you optimize, right? Where you optimize. And so he starts breaking down what optimize means. And it means to make the best of, the most of, the most positive as you can, you know, you can be. And he broke the optimizing down into four different components, which are time, talent, treasury, and relationships. And these are the areas that if we put our best foot forward in and we put our best self in and our vulnerability in and allow our fear not to be fed, then we blossom into the person that we were meant to be. So this is like mad rich, you know, I'm sitting there and I'm like, oh my God, this is so on deck because I feel like I'm going through this transition with my career. I don't know where I'm going and what I'm doing. Y'all, I am sweating. I came out the shower and I got to tell you something right now. It is buckets of sweat. Nerves is going, but I'm still here. We in this. So he's talking. And suddenly he closes that message And he takes this sharp right turn and starts talking about marriage. And I'm like, whoa, this is nuts. Like, okay, great, you know. And what he had to say, again, it just like compacted this whole idea about what it is that I'm talking about getting down to the root of who you are before you start wanting and asking for things. So I'm just going to read you what I wrote down. I said, maybe marriage for me was in the soul and the body only. Marriage is of the spirit. For me to desire marriage at this time would be in service of my soul and my body only. And it can't sustain in that place. I then now have no reason or desire for marriage until I moved into the full potential of my spirit. In this final week of 2017, the whole year, but this week, it has been remarkable. The way that the Lord is working in me and through me is remarkable. I said to my best friend Thursday night, I realized my desire to marry has been equally tied to my want to fix the brokenness from my childhood and my desire to emulate the nurturing love of my grandmother and my mother that have been instilled in me. And God said, hear me now. That time has passed. Whatever has wronged you in your childhood or your past cannot be undone or redone through any actions that I take in the now or in the future. I know he has seen to it that I am an overcomer, and no amount of effort in the now can change what has infinitely taken place. And that's the summary. That's the takeaway. You know, it was just like, I don't need to do that. I don't need to waste time in doing that. You don't need to do that. You know, there's nothing that needs to go on that you can't release and be helped to heal from, instead of making commitments to things that you cannot uncommit. You can't uncommit from a child. You can't uncommit from a relationship. You can go your separate ways, but the experience still has to endure. And he just started, you know, he broke down the different areas of knowledge to consider when you're talking about how we exist in the world, and we're of the spirit, and we're of the soul, and we're of the body. And, you know, in those places, you kind of have to decide, like, where are you making your commitments? And I think a lot of people who get married and make commitments with their body, well, what happens to our body? We don't stay here forever. So that's like it's got to be a metaphor, right? You can't attach something forever in something that has a ticking time on it. So, you know, there's the body, and then the soul really exists in a way that is your desires and your passion and your personality and your emotions and your feelings and all that. But that stands to fluctuate also. It's not going to stay. It's not going to stay on an even keel, and it can grow and expand, and it can also condense and be crushed. Thank you. I appreciate that. I need that support. But it can do but so much. Here it is. This is it. This is the soul, right? So I met my soulmate. He's the best thing that ever happened to me. He's a married man with kids. I met my soulmate and I feel complete. He died. You know, my family's the best thing that ever came to me. They're ostracizing me because I'm gay. I mean, this can go on and on. Like, this is all, that's all soul stuff, and that's all temporal, you know? And so there you have it there. I can't get married in my body plane. I can't get married in my soul plane either. Because those things don't stay. They expand, contract, or deplete. But your spirit now, well, that continues to rise and rise and rise and supersede and has a knowing attached to it and a wisdom attached to it and an essence attached to it and a breath attached to it and a connection attached to it. So much so that you can love someone so much that you will never not love them, that the love goes with them when they transition and stays with you while you're still here. That's the realm that I want to get married in. And I realize that how much that realm is so infinite and attached to God's goodness and what it means to grow a relationship in a real way. You have to have a component that is way more complex, divine, and purposeful than who we are. Way more than who we are, because we're not the same every day. But you do know that the sun's going to shine. You know that. Or clouds. Or rain. Or snow. And that the night's going to come also. You know that. You can trust the fact that it's going to be a day and a night. It's going to be hot or cold. There's going to be warmth or, you know, or frigid air, right? There may be leaves or bare trees. There's nature you can actually trust because it's going to do what it knows how to do. Nature is not trying to be a human being. Right? So all of that is, that's God. All of that's God. All of that is spirit. All of that is a plan that is, it will never fail. And that's, to me, when people talk about having faith and really trusting in the fact that your faith can take you places that you can't see, that to me is really the essence of it. Also, it's really buckling down into the fact that what I'm sustained by every day that I may even take for granted is taking care of me. And I don't even say thank you half the time. My parasympathetic system that's letting me breathe this air in and out, all the ways my body responds to the temperature, to pain, to injury, to heartache, to loss, to food, to sleep, to lack thereof. All of this stuff is always going on and we don't say thank you for it. But that's the essence of the spirit also. So I feel like that magical place, that infinite place, that is the place where, should I walk down the aisle, that's where I need to be. And in a conscious way, I'm not there yet. And that's okay. I trust that if that's what is going to happen in my life, it'll unfold itself and it will come to fruition. But I'm just going to give you a little bit of what I wrote and share it with you, and then we'll wrap this up. And I look forward to it. Thank you so much to everybody that joined in and came and left. And I, you know, it doesn't even matter if you stayed or you left. It just, trying something new. I really don't even know why I'm nervous, but I'm sure it'll go away. It'll get easier as time goes on. And I'm not going to let my nerves get in the way because, believe me, I got a lot to talk about. Okay. So, talking about the body. And this is good too. Like, you can actually look at a lot of your relationships in this way. To ask yourself, like, where am I in this relationship? Like, what is this about? So if you're looking at the body, you're looking at food, water, clothing, shelter, rest, safety, security. In that body, in the body plane, you endure, you acquire, and you sustain. So that's your body. So if you are in a relationship with someone and it is only consisting in the body, figure out what kind of questions you need to ask yourself, because that may not be where you want to be. I'm going to divert a little bit for a second. This makes me think about, like, your 20s, my 20s at least, right? My 20s was all about the body. Always had that deepness feeling going on the inside. But let's face it, in your 20s, you're young, you're hot, your hormones are raging, you're curious about the world, you know, you're jumping on things, you're putting shit in your mouth. You're doing a lot of things, you're trying new stuff, you know? But you kind of can only see as far as you are. And so as you mature, I feel like this conversation about who you are and your soul and, like, the substance of who you are starts to evolve as you get a little bit older in your 20s. So we move to the soul and this plane. You're talking about personality. People who have really strong personalities are, like, people who really want to be seen and really want to be acknowledged. That's what you call a really strong personality, right? Their soul might have a really strong purpose also. But in the soul plane, there's connection, there's love, there's certainty, which is peace of mind. There's uncertainty, which is vulnerability and variety and excitement and thrill and surprise. You have significance. You want to feel special. You want to feel unique. You want to feel important. And in this plane, we express, we emote, we desire, and we connect. Here is the apex for most of us until our relationship with God has taken on a more primary stance. God expounds on what we experience here, giving us the opportunity to elevate the experience of ourselves through Him while still contained in the human body. So I feel like the next level after the body would be your soul, right? So you can, this is how you have these moments where, you know, maybe if you meditate or you have maybe profound sexual experiences or if you get high. I mean, there's all different ways you can experience the supernatural or the spiritual world and still be in your body but not be too detached. So, you know, that's that soul plane. That's that place there. And I think what happens in the soul plane a lot of times, I think people's ego, I think it gets, you know, this is where we can get stuck, because in order to get to that next plane, there's a word that starts with an S that needs to be going on. But when you get stuck in the soul, the only thing that you really feel that you have rulership over is your body. And all of that's, it's all, again, it's still impermanent. It doesn't last. And so you know, here in that soul and body place, we can create all these bridezilla weddings, and, you know, we can create all this design, like how we want to make marriage look, who we think we are, what's in, you know, it's like, this is where mankind kind of starts to go haywire, in my personal opinion. They just start to power through, like, this is how I'm going to do it, and this is how I'm going to do it. But it's almost like biology, like, it's just going to happen the way that it's supposed to happen, no matter what your opinion or your thought process is. It is what it is. You don't have to like it. Thank you, Jeff, for those hearts. It's very sweet. So that's what you got. Body plane, soul plane. So I think a lot of people, you know, this is the area where most people are like, oh, I met my soulmate. You got plenty of soulmates. Absolutely. Why couldn't you? Why couldn't you? I believe that you could definitely have tons of soulmates, but spirit mate, that's something different, right? So we get to the next level and we're talking about the spirit. And in the spirit, Pastor Bernard shared with us that this is the plane where you grow and contribute. That is the primary thing going on there. So in this plane, it's the infinite. Here is where we're connected to the divine and each other. Here is where we sow seeds that we reap and that our seeds reap as well. So that's another level. In the spirit world, the world that starts with an S that no one really signs up for, but if you're smart, I think you allow it to happen. Surrender. Yeah, you're not getting into that spirit plane with ego. It's not going to work out. You could try. People do it all the time. No, spirit mate, soul mate, soul ties, twin flames are not the same. A spirit mate is connected to a divine source. You're talking about, I'm taking the words itself. So a spirit mate, we're talking about God. Because a lot of people don't want to name God, right? We want to, you know, God knows mankind wants to do their own thing. So, all right, I hear that. But we're talking about God, whoever you call God. Well, I'm going to call him God. Your spirit mate would be in design of who you are, which is in an intention that cannot be defined by you. It has nothing to do with your ego. It has nothing to do with you. It's not involved. It's the parents that had you and the experiences that came about, that it's not in your control. This is vulnerability. Gotta have vulnerability to be hanging out in the spirit plane, because you don't know what's coming. You don't know what's going on. You don't know what's for you. You have to wait. You have to surrender. You have to be vulnerable. You got to be flexible. You have to breathe. That's different. Soulmates, soul ties, twin flames, that's all in the soul plane. So that's just as wide as my body can go. We can have spiritual experiences, but there's no situation here where that means that God is in your spirit and in my spirit, and we're going to grow and contribute. Two different things, all the way, absolutely together. Where people get stuck with this soulmate, soul twin, soul tie, twin flame, that shit is about sex. Let's call a spade a spade. If your soulmate is not someone who's a friend, because you can have friends who are soulmate, I believe that. That's about sex, okay? Sex ain't going with you. When you lay down, you take your last breath, your vagina and your penis stay here. They're not going. No, they're not going. They're staying here. They have no use. It's actually kind of sad. When people are asking other people, like, well, how many bodies you had? Does it really matter? Because they're going to get left behind with my vag when I close my eyes. It doesn't even matter, you know? So, no, it's not a space way. And the reason I'm saying it is because there's an extension as to how far sex is going to take you in relationship to another person. It's overdone. It's over exhausted. It's over tried. It's over penetrated, right? There's nothing wrong with sex. God knows I love sex. But there's a time for everything. Right now is not that time for me. I have no issue with that. There's a place that you can go to with someone where you grow. We're not talking about moving from ignorant thoughts to positive ones, or drinking tap water and then alkaline, or eating conventional and now you're organic and non-GMO. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about real growth that is expansive, that takes you past the goddess in you, that takes you past the God in you. This doesn't have to do with them. This is about the oneness. I'm not going to be, you know, 45. I'm not going to tell you who your God is. I'm not going to go that far. We got much more Thursday nights to go, okay? But this is beyond that. This is beyond the God and Goddess business. I get all of that. I've been there. Had the tantric lover. It was great. It was fantastic. The most connected. And but guess what? That's as far as it can go. That's as far as it can go. The sex coming into two people coming into one, this oneness. The divinity in that is the creation of a person, right? You can't get no more divine than creating a person by somebody busting off. That is elegance. I mean, I'm creative, but I can't even create something more divine than that. That I can be laying with a man and in love or whatever we're in. It doesn't even matter the state of mind we're in. Like, think, like, really think about that. It's not like drinking and driving where if you're sober, you get to the place you're going to more safely. You could be drunk. You could be sober. It doesn't even matter. It doesn't even matter. You lay down. You connect. And a divine human being with an intention and a purpose is created. That is spirit work. That ain't soul work. That's God. That's it. That's God. Because there's an intention for each person that's coming through. So that divinity that goes on between two people, this whole shit being turned on its head where sex is this casual interaction and everyone's just bumping genitals and, you know, all this wild shit is going on. I'm not saying experimentation is not necessary. And I'm not saying, like, putting the fire out inside of you isn't necessary. You are human. I'm not asking of or suggesting anyone be puritanical because that hasn't been my walk. But there comes a point where you have to kind of just get a little bit deeper inside yourself and ask some questions about how you're treating your home, which is your body. And this is men and women, right? So it's not even about the number that you invite in. It's not that, but what, why? Not even who or what, why is it okay for someone to be inside me? Because I wrote a piece on this and I'll do this another week. Maybe we'll talk about it next week. But to me, a penis comes with a promise. A penis starts with a P because it comes with a promise. There is a responsibility behind having a penis. Okay? It's this. If I do this to you, you see this? Look at that. Look, I'm looking at you. I'm hello. Good night. Look at that. Something comes at you like that. It's aggressive. Okay? I'm trying to tell you something. Well, this is what a penis does. It has a point. Another P word. It has a point. It has a promise. It's a purpose. Okay? You don't just this running up in women business without being involved in promise and responsibility and women. Not just having, that's right. Responsibility comes with it. And women not just being like, you need to pay for this. No, pay for what? Is he being spiritually responsible to you? Is he being emotionally responsible to you? Is he being respectful to you? If you're sick, is he calling you? Are you holding him accountable? Are you holding yourself accountable? Is somebody holding you accountable? All right, we jumping a gun. Yep. Family, y'all got me turned up. We ain't there yet. All right. Time check. What time is it? Hold on. All right. So this is a 40-minute conversation. It's all we got. Ooh, this is lit. All right. So yeah, next week we'll get into that conversation. Let's talk next week about the promise of the penis. Let's talk about the promise of the penis. And the Lord will speak to me this week and he will give me more information because I wrote a bunch. But I also want to talk about, yes, please, promise. Look at all them P words. Penis, promise, penetration. Hello? Okay. But we're going to get to it. We got time. We got time. Okay. Well, if there's women who's claiming that they just want the money, you may want to look inside yourself and figure out why those kinds of women are around you. Yeah. Definitely figure that out. But yeah. So next week we're going to talk about the promise of the peas. We'll talk about the promise of the pussy and the promise of the penis. And and what that means. But for now, just to recap really quickly, tonight we talked about marriage and the intention behind marriage and what that really means, and asking yourself if that is what you're doing because that is what you want to do, if that's what you feel to do, or if you're trying to repair something inside that you feel that you want to fix, and really being honest about that and making commitments to people and situations that are real, that reflect your spirit, not your body, not your mind, and not your soul, your spirit. And that takes work. That's what, you know, when people talk about the covenant of a relationship with the Lord, that covenant, we're gonna work all of this out, by the way, when we start talking about Christianity and what it means to the words that get thrown around that never get explained to many of us, because we just going to church because our parents feel like we should go. And I don't have any regrets about that. I'm glad my parents brought me to church. It put some sanctification inside of me and got me to where I'm at right now. So I'm grateful for it. But things do need to be explained. And that covenant is so important, because that covenant is the relationship and how you are spoken to directly. When the Bible talks about not needing an intercessor would be a pastor or a preacher. Without needing that intercessor, you and the Lord can have these direct conversations. He tells you exactly what he wants you to put out into the world, how it needs to get done, what the purpose is, and so on and so forth. So I'm just trying to follow what's going on in my covenant in these conversations. And I encourage you all to do the same. I really do. I want to see us all not just win for the sake of winning, not winning because we don't want to lose, but winning in terms of what it means to satisfy our intention as a person. And I think we'll revisit marriage again for sure. But I think sometimes the marriage piece gets a little chaotic, you know, especially as the older you get as a woman. For me, I want to get married and have children, which many people feel like, why would you do that? Wow, okay, I didn't know it was a crime to try and make a family first. A unit? Is it a crime? No one's judging. If you didn't go that route, 'tis your business too. I'm trying something else. Is that okay? And you know, if you allow ego, society, TV, Instagram, if you allow this to happen, you start putting this pressure on yourself. Like, I got to get this done. I got to get married. I got to have this kid. I got to da 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 da. But that's all you're doing. This is what you're doing to yourself. This is what you're doing to yourself. You got to do this. And so many women, so many people, men and women actually, they don't only do this. They do this. And that, and this, and walk down the aisle anyway, and deal with it anyway, and just go along with it anyway, because they want to be honest with themselves. Tell the truth to yourself first. Stop being stressed about telling somebody else the truth. Tell yourself the truth first. And our work for the week is just, you know, just asking ourselves, like, what are we lying about? What are we lying about? You don't have to tell me, but ask yourself, what are you lying about? God is not an outside thing. It's an inside thing. So once you feel God in your body, you know God. I can see that. I think for me, in my experience, it's an outside and an inside. It definitely is an inside experience. But I think it's a mirror. It's like a mirrored experience. It's like a reflection. It's in and it's out for me. All right. I love all y'all. I really do. Every Thursday, we are here. Thank you, girl. Nancy and Lisa and Lisa and Lexi and Tor and Usman and Janine and Bellissima and Carrie and Just Results and Young Brooklyn. And who else am I missing? I think that's everybody. And Sola and R. Fleming. And Susie and Jeff. Thank you so much, guys. And Vonetta. And Spot in Queens. Oh, and the Watson Chronicles. Hi. And Najee and Sean. And Ala Brown and Island Bully and Carrie. I don't know if I said your name twice. And Rayon. Rayvon. The Legend. You must be Jamaican. Bullet. And Page 125 and Christina and Princess Kamoto Who else? Mr. Marcus, I hope it ain't the one who be doing the videos. Get out of here. And Mikey. And Pody the Chef. Thanks, guys. I'll see you next Thursday. Mwah, mwah, mwah. Tell the truth to yourself this week. I want to hear all about it. Next Thursday, 9 o'clock. Night. Oh, I did it. 46 minutes.